They're low since this is lunch and everybody's probably got puppy belly, but we're actually very honored and pleased to be here, and I was flattered to be asked to moderate this. So at the Intel Center, we started looking at megacities problem sets in December of 14, following a lot of work that the Chief of Staff of the Army's SSG did. We brought that into TRADOC forums, and I'm real happy to see the mad scientist effort link in with our efforts here at ASU and to start to talk about this. If everybody knows, blinding flash the obvious, but it's obviously a very large challenge to consider how are you going to conduct Army operations in dense urban areas or megacities. And we all know that we have to do it. We can't ignore the problem set anymore. One of the biggest challenges is a challenge of density. It's density of population groups, it's density of infrastructure, and it's density of data. And there are all of those things that commanders, you know, have to work their way through. It's clearly part of the complex operating environment and the known and the unknowns as you work through the Army operating concept. And I hope that we have some good discussions today from the members of our panel. The biggest challenge on the intel side is how do we get after situational understanding for the commander so that they understand the decisions that they make and the second and third order impacts of those decisions, not only on threats, and we have a tendency to be threat-oriented, but it's also within the environment and the system of systems that's inside a megacity. One of the things that the SSG came out with that we thought was interesting is that the city is not necessarily an element of Army analysis. We look at nation states, we look at threats, we look at terrain, but we don't necessarily look at cities. And that's got to be another element of our analysis as we start to build the phase zero, phase one, two information requirements is how do we analyze a city? It's different. It's unique. And we got to start to take a look at that as well. With that, I'm going to close my remarks. We have four very learned, distinguished guests. I'm very happy to have them here. I'll do a full bio as we introduce each one, but Colonel Patrick Dugan, member of the Strategic Land Power Task Force, Dr. Amy Richmond from West Point, Colonel retired Kevin Felix, currently a senior consultant with the Roosevelt Group. I've known Kevin for probably the last 4 or 5 years. He was also with ARCIC. And then CW4 Dennis Castellanos, who is a member of the Maneuver Center of Excellence Commanders Initiatives Group. Let me introduce our first speaker real quickly. Got to find the bio page here. So Colonel Patrick Dugan graduated in 1995 from North Georgia College. You are extremely young compared to most of us in this room. It's probably not your best quality, though. Colonel Dugan's commanded at numerous levels in SOF, many regions of the world, to include the Asia Pacific and the Middle East. He's a graduate of the Army War College Fellowship at the Naval Postgraduate School, currently the SOF Fellow to the Strategic Land Power Task Force in the National Capital Region. Has numerous publications and articles, primarily linking cyber and special operations capabilities. And I'm going to ask him to give about a 10-minute opening remarks, and then we're going to move down all four panel members, and then we'll try to open it up for questions. And I've excoriated the panel members to limit to 10 minutes so that we do have time for questions. So, Colonel Dugan, you want this up here, right?
Yeah, please.
Thanks.
So I'm going to try to keep it to 10 minutes. First, I want to thank Arizona State University and TRADOC for the honor and privilege to be speaking in front of you all. I have the dubious honor of waking you up after that awesome lunch, so thank you all for that. So I am a career Special Forces officer, and no, I'm not going to eat a snake up here or ride a horse. I'm probably going to do something more bizarre. I'm going to talk about cyberspace, and I'm going to talk specifically about cyber-enabled special warfare in megacities. So you see, the past several years, my interests and my passions have been about cyber warfare and special warfare and the intersection of them. And from a soft guy's human-centered perspective, that's the way I look at things. And I think fundamentally, whatever topic du jour we want to talk, hybrid warfare, gray zone conflict, fourth generation, urban warfare, megacities, whatever, the immutable element to all of it is the human element. And that we have got to start viewing and using cyberspace for its human potential, especially in megacities where humanity lives, thrives, and increasingly fights. So I have some pictures. There they are. These are the three things I'm going to cover. And the first one is that, hey, we must change the Army's organizational attitudes towards cyber. When it comes to cyberspace discussions with senior leaders, I can see their eyeballs rolling back in the back of their head because they just don't get it. It sounds like some technical porpoise speak, and they're like, ah, make the bad guys stop, right? It's a generational thing, and I think it will work itself out. But in the meantime, organizationally, I think that the Army has abrogated cyber into a signals or an intel thing, or now a cyber branch thing, and that's wrong. Cyberspace is an everybody thing. It is an infantry problem, it's a special forces, it's an armor, it's an aviation. We all swim in the sea of cyber. And we have got to change our process, that's a unicorn for you, to find and use these unicorns, primarily some of the millennials coming up, that can do different things. They have a combat arm skill, but it's a non-traditional cyber talent. Check it out. They're not going to fit cleanly in our nice STEM boxes with our antiquated promotion and command tracks. We got to think differently and move forward. On that, we've got to innovate new ideas, new concepts, and new constructs for warfare, especially in megacities. You see, from a strategist's perspective, technology means nothing. Technology only matters if it drives a new capability, a new concept, a new construct, and a new way of fighting. Take this picture, for example. Hey, I don't know why every infantryman is not trained on ad hoc wireless mesh networks with non-standard devices for virtual remote fires using IPsec VPN tunneling protocol over surrogate domains. It's not that hard. I could train you on it in a week. This is the future, ladies and gentlemen, and we are way behind our adversaries. You see, success in warfare is not derived by labeling its assembled parts and disassembling it. It's achieved by correctly assembling emerging technology and cyber capabilities into trusted fields of human practice. And megacities are cyberspace's human battleground. Diversity is a good thing. Organizationally, we must do a better job at leveraging other organizations' authorities, missions, their access, their placement, but most of all, their influence in these hyper-connected urban areas. Fundamentally, we need a second tranche of cyber warfare development beyond our current build. And ultimately, to remain competitive, we've got to vigorously pursue these concepts for cyber warfare and megacities. All right, so what is cyberspace? What is it? Obviously, it depends who you ask. But I'll tell you from a soft perspective, cyber is a human space. It is as dynamic and uncertain as human nature. It is no longer simply this technical abstraction or man-made domain unto itself. It is a growing facet of everyday life that is increasingly cutting across every aspect of military operations. Cyber is a dynamic space. I think it is a global commons of human practice because it embodies the actions, the behaviors, and decisions of man. And it's rapidly becoming the preferred venue for how humans engage and fight one another on a daily basis. Cyber is also an uncertain space because individuals have more access to information than entire governments once possessed. And this new power and influence is rapidly diffusing to those who didn't have it before, allowing many-to-many communication where practically any consumer of information can also become a producer. And this phenomena has enabled practically anybody in the world to simultaneously communicate with anybody else. All right, so what? Why should you care? Well, I'll tell you, the explosion of technology, information, and network connectivity will not stop. It will only get faster. And our adversaries are well ahead of us, especially in urban areas. Russia. Madeleine Albright recently said, hey, this is the first time since World War II that European borders have been altered by force. Russia's brilliant cyber-enabled unconventional warfare in eastern Ukraine resulted in invading this EU signature partner nation without sparking really any meaningful Western response. Russia has mastered this deliberate choreography of cyber warfare and unconventional warfare in urban areas because it takes time to set the conditions with the separatist militias so that you can infiltrate the unmarked Spetsnaz carrying laptops to do electronic warfare jamming, DDoS attack, as well as reach back to Putin's troll army for this deluge of misinformation that further obfuscated their actions on the ground. Whew, catch my breath. Trying to race the clock here. Iran. These two clowns up here are the grand architect. Iran's cyber-enabled counterinsurgency has been a stunning success in urban areas, not once but twice. They have crushed two separate rebellions, both domestically and abroad, which never triggered any meaningful Western response. They have blended a national to tactical cyber capability by reconstructing and synchronizing the besieged cyber units, their Quds Force, and their IRGC clandestine architecture. And they used this capability in 2009 to strangle the Green Movement, ironically, with the same thing that was supposed to liberate them, cyberspace. And then in 2012, they took some of those same soft cyber experts, put them in Syria to grind through using cyber-enabled counterinsurgency to help Assad. All right, ISIL. ISIL's strategic advantage is their human-attuned, state-of-the-art cyber technology use. They have mastered this ICT, information communication technology, ontology through their social media applications, their cinematography, and their magazines that, frankly, we haven't. And they have done this time and again. They've invested in intellectual investment. They have mobilized action by tapping into, again, the human emotion, psychology, and passion by exploiting those long-standing Sunni grievances with messages that resonate, they have reach, and they're relevant. Fundamentally, ISIS has pioneered crossing the threshold abroad into American and European cities to push targeted audiences already primed for their messages from aspirational to operational with cyber messaging. All right, last slide. Everybody has a role in cyberspace. As the director of the NSA said recently, and I quote, no single entity has all the necessary insight, authorities, capabilities, or resources to protect and defend U.S. and allied interests in space. And I couldn't agree with them more. You see, cyberspace is not just an intel or signals thing. It is an everybody thing. So the Army as an institution must force every branch to bring something to the table. Hey, infantry, where's your cyber movement to contact in megacities? Hey, armor, where's your cyber screens and built-up areas? Hey, aviation, where's your logistics plans to avoid the hacker nets exploiting the internet of evil things for your logistics trains around your airfields? And here's the takeaway, ladies and gentlemen. Cyberspace is a human space, and megacities are becoming its preeminent battleground. I'm out. Thanks.
Thanks, Colonel Dugan. Our next speaker is Dr. Amy Richmond, Professor at West Point. Get to the notes so that I don't mess this up. She focuses on the interactions between the environmental resources and the human populations and currently has some significant studies for sub-Saharan Africa. Please welcome Dr. Amy Richmond. You want to take a seat?
good afternoon, and thank you for having me. The picture behind me is of the Kasubi slum in Kampala, Uganda. I do most of my research on household-level vulnerability in Uganda, and although Kampala is not a megacity with a mere 1.5 million population, it is rapidly growing, exponentially growing. And since we're talking about the future, most of the projected urban growth in the future is actually expected to take place in these mid to small-sized cities. And as Abe Usher showed us this morning with his interactive maps, East Africa is currently the least urbanized area, but the most rapidly urbanizing area. So I think talking about Kampala offers us some really interesting insights on trying to understand growth. The picture is of three private bathroom stalls, and 80 families use these stalls. Right next to it, there is a water spigot built by an NGO some time ago. The prospect of these non-operational water spigots getting fixed is bleak. The only water tank in the entire slum is a 10,000-liter freshwater tank nearby, which can also only support 80 families. The entire population of the slum is 50,000. The water tank is managed by one of the leaders of the slum, who is a woman, who determines which families have access to the tank. Other families have to buy water, which is very expensive, or they rely on water from natural sources, which include rainfall, puddles from leaky pipes, or ditches which are contaminated with sewage and garbage. The ratio of working taps to people in the slums of Kampala is on average 1 to 64. Urbanization increasingly means the poorest, most vulnerable people move into huge slums. These areas exhibit high level of poverty and inequality, and the risk that these informal urban areas will detach themselves even further from government or effective government control, and they will instead be made up of local power structures that may come to constitute a threat to the city and ultimately the state itself. As General Odierno and Michael O'Hanlon mentioned in their recent article, scale is a major contributor to the complexity of urbanization. As cities grow, their vulnerabilities grow, and often in nonlinear ways. Massive growth creates new, weakly governed spaces where criminals and extremists can exist. When trying to make sense of these rapidly growing urban areas, several major themes emerge. First, let's take a second to define slum. The UN defines a slum household as a group of individuals living under the same roof lacking one or more of the following conditions: access to improved water, access to improved sanitation, sufficient living area, durability of housing, and security of tenure. Slums are a clear manifestation of poorly planned urban, urban sector. In many rapidly growing cities, the majority of the population lives in slums. In Kampala, 60% of the population lives in a slum. 55 million new slum dwellers have been added to the population since 2010. There are five major components that perpetuate slum conditions and consequently household vulnerability. First, these settlements lack basic infrastructure, such as waste management systems, sanitation, improved water sources. They have unpaved and poorly maintained roads and lack access to emergency services. Lack of adequate access to emergency services, such as functioning fire trucks, place these populations at a huge risk in the event of a disaster. However, even if emergency services were adequate, access to many of these slum neighborhoods is significantly restricted, if not impossible, because of poor infrastructure. Second, land rights are notoriously complicated in slum areas, and there is differential access to land and water. In some cases, entire slums can be owned by just a handful of people. In other cases, it is almost impossible to understand who owns or who has rights to the land. Land is not only critical for providing a residence, but it also provides a source of food. Urban agriculture is a key component of the urban mosaic, and it's also a critical and functioning part of the informal economy. It also provides food, and local food prices can often be too high, so people rely on household farms for their significant source of calories. Rapid population growth because of migration and natural increase results in overcrowding. Also, the average age of a household is very young. In Kampala, it is not uncommon to find the head of the household to be a child between the ages of 14 and 17. The majority of slum dwellers operate in the informal economy. Informality is an inevitable occurrence in developing countries because the formal sector cannot keep up with the sheer magnitude of population growth. Informality is a consequence of the inability of the informal sector to keep up with that growth. They have become a critical component and distribution mechanism of the formal sector. They have also become so intertwined, so the formal and informal are so intertwined that they cannot be distinguished from one another. And these sectors can be sufficiently organized to affect political outcomes. Informal government and governance and relationships all influence these factors. We should seek to understand what this informality looks like. Why is this important? If, for example, a natural disaster or civil conflict were to occur, whom would we talk to? Who has influence? The informal to formal relationship structure, which is often nonlinear, challenges the tactical to operational mission command structure, which is often more linear. In other words, tactical elements in these environments are likely to find themselves within the informal network. At the operational level, host counterparts are formal, and often the informal and the formal, it's a nonlinear relationship, so they're not communicating. For example, let's look at this, let's take water and use this notional network. Water is consumed in primarily three sectors: gardening, households, and commercial. Many households obtain water from multiple sources. In Kampala, 40% of the population lacks access to piped water, and therefore households rely primarily on springs, communal taps, and open water sources. Analysis of this network can show which households are reliant on which sources, and which suppliers, in turn, wield the most economic and possibly political influence. The second layer is this distribution layer. In many cities, the water supply network consists of multiple connected components. Successfully mapping the city's water distribution network could have important implications for residents' vulnerability in the event of a civil conflict or, for example, the outbreak of an infectious disease like cholera. A waterborne disease like cholera. The resource management network will show which actors control and govern the use of communal resources, including water, sanitation, and land. Understanding these connections can help explain what barriers there are and which actors need to sign off or be appeased before changes can be implemented. In addition, this type of analysis can identify potential flashpoints for conflict over these resources, be they turf wars over the rights to sell services, land ownership disputes, or even resistance against the expansions of services into new areas. Understanding vulnerability and these types of social networks will help us understand access to resources so that we can better be prepared to address the challenges that we are facing in rapidly growing cities. We must also consider the importance of planning. Successful planning relies on good governance, which often is ineffective and unorganized and often not trusted by the local community. Planning should not just focus on physical plans, but also on managing social sustainability. As Lily Kong at Singapore Management University states, when millions of people with different backgrounds and cultures come into contact with each other, managing social tensions becomes as important as providing for essential infrastructure like housing or plumbing. In this brief presentation, I highlighted some of the complexity that exists in a rapidly growing urban area. Whether operating as small teams of specialized enablers or as a larger formation responding to crisis, our forces engaging in this unfamiliar terrain must be able to interpret these informal centers of gravity and realize the extent that their spheres of influence. And moreover, how and where and at what level informal and formal powers mesh. Only by doing so can we properly analyze this challenging operational environment, lowering the risk of marginalizing our forces to the population, which also increases the odds of mission success. As Dr. Crow, the ASU president, mentioned this morning, we need to address, and I would argue, embrace the complexity. Before I end, I just want to have a couple, just say a couple acknowledgments to my West Point students, Ian Myers and Gabby Talley, whose work directly influenced this presentation. We're really fortunate to be funded by Minerva, and I'm able to take these students to Africa for our summer AIDs, as we say at West Point, and they are able to actually be in the field in Africa gathering data that then they can use for their honors thesis. And I'm really excited about a new collaboration with the Network Science Institute at Northeastern University with Kate and Matt. Their thinking helped me develop some of those network ideas. And the future for us is to use network analysis and geographical maps of vulnerability and try and mesh them together. So thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions.
Third speaker is Colonel Retired Kevin Felix. As I said earlier, worked with him for the past 4 or 5 years. He used to run the Future Plans, Future Thinking Division, Concepts Division at ARCIC. Currently works for the Roosevelt Group. He's a former artillery officer, FAO, big thinker, and used to challenge me all the time. I usually lost. Kevin, please.
Good afternoon. So as the chief of future warfare, just a little over a year ago, I used to have responsibility for running these kinds of things. So first of all, thanks, Mr. Greco, for inviting me. And I just want to give a shout out to Kira and her team, because while this looks all really smooth, and it is, she's got webbed feet and they're moving like crazy, and all of her teammates, because this is not an easy thing to pull off, having some experience with that. And Tony Garner, my former battle buddy there in Future Warfare Division, can attest to that as well. I would also say that the webinars that you all did were fantastic, and I participated in 3 of those, and it was a great way to lead into this and to get everybody charged up. Really outstanding event. So the title of this presentation is about rebuilding a roadmap for sustained collaboration, learning, and training. And I emphasize the rebuilding part because, as we all know, there's really nothing new about operating in dense spaces. But what we're learning today and over the next 2 days is what's changed and how it's going to continue to be more complex, and we need to embrace those complexities. And I think everybody is appreciating that as we go forward here. The other thing about rebuilding is that there was a plan, and the former Joint Forces Command had responsibility for that. And I'll talk a little bit about that here. And so really it's about re-energizing the effort. So as the Chief of Future Warfare, in September of 2013, I was outbriefing General Odierno. It's his future study plan, Unified Quest. And we had just finished talking about the last year's war game. And I said, sir, we've been working on strategic trends, and one of those that continues to get readdressed is this idea of rapid urbanization. So next year, in the spring, we will conduct a war game on megacities. And he said, great. And at that time, the newly formed strategic studies group was under Dr. Johnson was getting underway, and he said, hey, get my SSG involved. And so that was a great partnership that first year in kind of kicking the door open on this whole idea of the megacity, culminated in this deep future war game. So following that, the SSG took it and ran with it and has done phenomenal work, really, really great work. So that's kind of the background and the framework for it. Next chart, please. So at the end of that, Lieutenant Colonel Fred Wong and I worked on a paper. And that paper was part of a forum with the U.S. Army War College. And, it appeared to be somewhat, controversial in terms of who was for it and who was against this idea of megacities. But as you look through, and I would offer to you, the three papers are really good, because while one says for and one says against, it's really the against was, well, we shouldn't just focus on megacities. Well, fundamentally, that's true. And the third paper talked about the fact that we need to look back at all the work that has been done, and I just described that, some of the work in the early 2000s by the Joint Forces Command that was being done on this very idea. And of course, life has a way of taking hold, and so we've got to deal with operations in Iraq and Afghanistan that really put this on the back burner, and it's great to see that it's coming back, because that trend is not changing, and we need to appreciate it. So there's really six lines of effort there that I talk about in the paper. First is reflect and assess. Then there's learn and test, build, collaborate, establish, and finally sustain. So next chart, please. So the first one's reflect and assess. So again, not a new idea, but we need to continue to look at this very, very carefully, and this is a great forum to do it. So the responsibility, again, with Joint Forces Command, assessing and learning, and so we have a responsibility to go back. And that was one of the first things that General McMaster, when he came in, talked about. He goes, we got to stop relearning things. We got to learn the right things, because we got to assess what we've already learned and take an account through the right repositories of all the learning that's gone on. And that led to an effort with Army Warfighting Challenges, and I'll talk a little bit about that as well. So anyway, in 2000, the GAO actually did a study, and it was the focused attention needed to prepare U.S. forces for combat in urban areas. That was in February of 2000. That was followed by Joint Experiment Urban Resolve from 2004 to 2006. And then the Joint Forces Command had what's called the Joint Urban Operations Master Plan, 2012 to 2017. That was published in February of 2006. So again, you can see that there's been some work that has gone on. We have this responsibility to go back into the repository and bring that all forward. Next chart. So the learn and test. So wargaming and experimentation are extremely critical in this process. While we did at Unified Quest, did war games in 2004, looked back at those, what did we learn, and then moved forward in 2014 with another war game, it is really the beginning. It's about kicking the door open on the idea. It's almost as if it's the signaling device for the Army on the big ideas at the operational and strategic level, and then follow that with experimentation to make sure you get to the entity-based requirements to help with that capability development. And so this combination of wargaming and experimentation are critical to moving this forward. And while there may have been one war game, we have to build, again, this roadmap. Too easily will things like this, as I've experienced over 4 years of doing this, things change, life takes hold, the enemy has a vote, and we start to go in a different direction. And so it's a great opportunity now, with a lot of energy and momentum on this topic, to get back into it. Next chart. Build. And here's where I want to talk a little bit about AWFC number 8, as was the number 4 on the opportunities chart there. And I'll have my single mad scientist moment here. So, first of all, when I talk about build, I talk about advanced virtual, constructive, and gaming capabilities. This is really an area of tremendous opportunity for us to create first-class simulation capabilities to be able to look across various megacities throughout the world and recreate those in a simulated environment in many different ways, to include in the gaming world. And then I talk about their focused training opportunities at the operational and strategic level. If you look in the upper right of that chart, that is a picture of the 2015 OSD report to Congress on sustainable ranges. In that document, it talks about the number of mount sites in the Army that we have. We have 87 mount facilities in the United States Army. 81 of those are seen as fully mission capable. That's a pretty good number. So the point is, we have a lot of capability at the tactical level. And where we need to think about it is, how do we operate and train at the operational and at the strategic level? And so one of the things in the lower right corner, there's two documents there. One is on the left is a document that reflects our requirements to be able to operate UAVs in the urban terrain. And the second one is a Department of Defense instruction that talks about realistic military training off federal real property. In other words, there are rules about how to do this, and we ought to think about it. So instead of, and the chief right now is struggling with the way that we should train. He's got a requirement out to look at 1,000 acres. He wants 1,000 acres to be able to train a BCT. So there's a number of different courses of action out there. Many of them are existing tactical range, urban range facilities. And the consideration is to make those even more dense, to create the dense core. But I would offer, as you've heard from these speakers and you'll hear from others, that the idea of the megacity, we lose the idea in terms of numbers because we think, okay, well, that definition is of a megacity is 10 million. And so we don't like the name. Well, I think the name is important because, especially for our junior leaders, it illuminates the challenge. It illuminates the complexities. If you say urban, we might lose that idea, that complexity. The megacity isn't just about the dense core, okay, urban core. It's about the dense core juxtaposed with the slums and the other open terrain and the littoral, potentially. And so all of that is very complex. Well, we ought to look around, and this is the kind of the mad scientist moment. We do a lot of this kind of training in the soft community at night. You don't hear much about it. Sometimes you do. Jade Helm is an example of how maybe things got out of control. But the point is, we ought to look across the nation and talk to our mayors and talk to our governors and say, look, this is the environment of the future. And we need to scale up our training in our urban centers. And I think the way to do that is through partnerships. Partnerships with our National Guard, the total force idea that already exists, but they're the linchpin between the active force, our Homeland Security, and our first responders. And I know the chief's going to talk next about first responders and a POI that they're producing that the SSG has worked. So I don't want to talk too much about that, but the key point here is, think about not doubling down on an open space, a piece of dirt, and then building containers and other things to try to create Oz somewhere in a place that's very benign, that's removed from the complexities that already exist in our urban cores and centers around the country. And begin those conversations about the future. And when you talk about partnerships, it opens up the opportunity for the conversation with our mayors and with our governors. Because not only is it about training our first responders, but that partnership, DOD can learn from first responders, DOD can learn from Guard, Guard can learn from the active force, as well as our first responders. That consortium of players, as well as the civic leaders and everybody involved, that consortium is pretty powerful. And so we learn in our urban centers so that we take those concepts and those capabilities and those TTPs and we go expeditionary with them when we have to. And so that's kind of the idea. Don't build something benign. Use our urban centers and have those conversations and begin those conversations now. And again, the chief's gonna talk more about that. And so finally, I also think that just like we see here today, the great partnership with ASU in this type of event, we need to formalize these type of partnerships. One of the things that I get a chance to do is to learn more about this idea of P4, the idea that there's a public, and a public-private partnerships that are growing across the country, across our installations. DOD doesn't have the money to do everything on their own. There's shared services and there's partnerships. That's the new wave of the way installations are operating. So everything that we do, we need to partner. And that's one of the themes for growth of installations and how installations are moving forward. And so, again, the idea of partnership's important. Next chart. Collaborate. We're all doing it here. This is a team sport for sure. We've got a lot of organizations that are involved in this. And so what are the ways that we can collaborate? And one of the best ways, next chart, is through the Army Warfighter Challenges. A great tool, one tool, but a great tool that allows us to integrate across all of the functional centers of excellence. Create those centers of excellence that allow us to, establish. Establish a center of excellence. So the big point here is it time to think about a center of excellence for this particular idea? Now, we normally have centers of excellence around functional, the maneuver, the fires, et cetera. But is this so unique and different and so complex that we need to have a center of excellence to drive home all of these various capabilities and to build those partnerships within this space? And finally, next chart, is sustain. Again, we sustain through the Army Warfighter Challenges. It's a great tool. It's very useful. If you look at it, everyone got a copy of it. There's 20 of them. First order problems, the solutions to which help drive our concept and capability development. So again, Warfighter Challenges. General Quintus, please share with General McMaster that I was up here and I was reading out of the same hymnal that he reads out of every day. Okay, but. Very, very useful tool. It helps us to consolidate our thinking. It's a great repository for learning and again, helps to integrate across all of our warfighting functions. So that's my part of this presentation, and I appreciate your time. Thank you.
And our last presenter is CW4 Dennis Castellanos, special operator, 26 years in the Army, served with the Army Ranger Regiment, 82nd Airborne, and 7th Special Forces Group. Currently, he's working at the Maneuver Center of Excellence, Fort Benning, in the Commander's Action Group, Initiatives Group, and please welcome Chief Castellanos.
About 35 slides I want to share with you. No, I don't have any slides, but what I like to do is just give you a bit of background of what our efforts are in terms of the subject, megacities and dense urban areas, on behalf of the Maneuver Center of Excellence. So I am the action officer and lead for this effort. We received a task early August to assist TRADEC and ARCIC on megacities and dense urban areas, and since then that task has been amended several times. So the latest one was received 24 February, and what it states is that the Maneuver Center of Excellence is tasked to develop a pilot program for an urban training detachment in megacities and dense urban area, and then also establish an urban studies program. As soon as we received the task back in August, we started to reach out to the folks that are already doing some work about on this subject, and started integrating into the community of interest, expanding it, reached out to the Strategic Studies Group, Intelligence Center of Excellence, FDNY, National Guard, 7th Group, and those folks, those organizations have been key contributors to our effort. And we would not have been able to done the progress that we have done up to today without their help. So on or about 2 November, we hosted a Future Maneuver Update. That's a biweekly battle rhythm event that the Maneuver Center of Excellence Commander puts together to reach out to the community of interest and discuss special topics like this, and the results were that we needed really to have a venue where we could come together all in the same room and gain the perspectives and really a deeper understanding of what efforts are each of the centers of excellence and other organizations that were interested in this topic doing about it, so we can better get a situational understanding of what that looks like. That seminar was hosted 29-30 March, and then at the same time, parallel to that effort, we were framing a concept for a pilot course. The first pilot course to take place in megacities was executed last week, and we were successful at pulling 10 captains that are currently attending the Maneuver Captain's Career Course all from different branches, armor, infantry, intel, aviation, fires. And one of the officers was branched from the Marine Corps. We won't hold that against him, but a great contributor to the group. So the basis for the five-day lecture-based urban terrain model for the course was really to pull from first responders like the FDNY, the National Guard, and then CDOEM. So baseline interaction with them to understand how they operate day in and day out in this environment. They're experts, and give us an opportunity for us to pull from their best practices, challenges, and lessons learned. Understanding that not all the skills and not all of their training is applicable to military operations. However, there are golden nuggets that we can pull from, and some of the skills are definitely transferable to military operations and lessons learned in terms of communication challenges in subterranean infrastructure, span of control, moving through dense urban areas, cities, and so on and so forth. So the number one observable from the course is, it cannot be overstated, the requirement to have a training venue where students can conduct an urban terrain model and be immersed in the city. You can watch a video, you can look at a picture, but you will not gain the same appreciation once you emerge in the cities. And to my surprise, I did not really know that we had members of the military that have never been to New York City. I'm a native, but it took me by surprise. In terms of resources, the number two observable was that we needed more time. So really 5 days was pretty fast and furious, gained a lot of knowledge and a lot of situational understanding. But the number two recommendation from the captains that attended was that we really needed more time to conduct decision-making training exercises and really tie it into military scenarios. In terms of resources, we conducted this training venue with $1,100 per person. If you were to buy a box of batteries to power your SingGuard's radio, you will not be able to buy that with $1,100. The average cost is about $1,400. And the way we got to reduce the cost of this training venue was by establishing early relationships with the garrison command of Fort Hamilton, who housed us free of cost. And along the same lines, we were able to set up the training venues and these training opportunities, all based from really bottom-up relationships with the FDNY, the National Guard, and CDOEM. So one note that I want to highlight is that for us to maintain these relationships, episodic engagements will not be the answer. That will sustain it for a near term. However, the Army needs to step up and do it more of a permanent presence in order to maintain these relationships. So one of part of the task and one of the concepts that we're working with is developing a training detachment that is permanently based at Fort Hamilton, so it becomes the voice and the face for the Army. And what this detachment will do is expand their relationships, sustain those relationships, find training opportunities, expand the network, and explore other organizations that are willing to cooperate with the military. FDNY has signed a memorandum of understanding to train with the Army, so it makes it easy for us to train with that organization, and it will definitely reduce the risk of social media impacts, as it was mentioned earlier before with Jade Helm and so on and so forth. The Maneuver Center of Excellence trains over 1,000 captains per year. We only took 10 this time around. There's no way that we're going to be able to afford, or nor should we, take 1,000 captains per year to New York City. So part of the concept is also a tier approach and focus on train-the-trainer concept. Using PME as a model for touch points, there's already, that's a professional military education pipeline. There's training organizations that already have urban operations module. However, they do not talk about megacities. For example, the Army War College visits New York City and visits some of the same infrastructure that we had a chance to visit last week. But there's no discussions of megacities from the strategic point of view or as a brigade commander lens. So one of the recommendations that will be forthcoming on our white paper as due to ARCIC here in about a month is to perhaps generate those discussions on early on at the basic level and throughout the different touch points during the professional military education. In terms of the composition of what this training detachment should look like, it's not firm. We're still wrestling with the idea, the concept, but we're looking for a wide range of expertise. It could be National Guard, it could be SOF, intel, armor, infantry, so on and so forth. We'd like to start out small, perhaps with the idea of recommending an internship that is assigned, a service member is assigned to one of the organizations that is willing to cooperate with us, and it works for that organization. And then it expands the network, understands the scheduling, the training opportunities. So we filter some of the hundreds of phone calls that some of these organizations are getting and asking permissions to conduct training in that environment. And at some point, they're going to really degrade our relationships. That's all I have. The next event that the MCOE is going to host is going to be the Future Maneuver Update, where we're going to cover the outcomes of the seminar and the outcomes of the pilot course that we hosted last week. And that is scheduled for the 4th of May. If you're interested in dialing in, you'll see me afterwards. It's going to be at 0900 Eastern. So if you're in the West Coast, that means you come in to work early that day. All right. Thank you for your time.
And we got pretty close. We have a few minutes left for questions. So while we tee up the first person, I just want to let Dr. Fran Zinzin told me to make sure that I got high energy and upped my game before I came up here.
So I
just want you to know this is me amped, okay? And this is it. Please, sir, when you do, identify your target that you want the question to go to first.
It's actually to the whole panel. Okay. I've heard a common threat coming at each of you in a different way. And first of all, you defined megacity, fiber as a human factor and megacities as the operational space. And you worked straight through to the Command Sergeant Major to the training base in Fort Hamilton, which I think is outstanding, putting the Guard in the lead because they live that way. They live in the city. But what all of you have been defining is whole of government, but you haven't kind of brought it out. It was a joint concept, and then the joint community kind of backed off of whole of government. But I think what you're describing is whole of government, and we need to get it back into conversation, I believe. I'd like to hear your comments.
Kevin, would you like to start on that one?
So the whole of government idea is not dead. This is really important stuff, and thanks for bringing that question to the group, sir. I think that as I was talking, I mentioned a few elements of that. You know, I talked about the Homeland Security, I talked about the first responders and other things, but yeah, it is much more than that. It is. It's the GIM, the Joint Interorganizational Multinational. All of those elements have to come together to be able to understand this problem set. Too often, I think we've been struggling with that in recent conflicts. A lot of hard work going in to try to resolve that. There's some capacity issues with some of our partners where we want them in many places often. And it's tough to get some of those other agencies, but that is absolutely the goal. And thanks for the question.
Patrick, you want to add, or Amy, Chief?
Yes, sir. So one of the observations from last week's event was that what we experienced was GIM without the M. So definitely a lot of opportunities, especially in our only mega city that we have in the United States, New York City. To interact with the Joint and the other organizations that are operating in that environment.
I agree. I think it's very important. I also think we need to consider the different levels of governance. I tried to bring that out a little bit in my talk. So you can have government that works the counterpart in the country might, you know, operate in the formal sector, but that falls apart when you start getting to the informal sector, which we would call ungoverned. But at the same time, it is governed. It's just not formally governed. And I think that we have to consider that when looking at this problem set as well.
That's not the horse I usually beat, so I'll pass.
Others?
So, first off, Chief. If you like, we can advertise your session in May using the Mad Scientist distribution list. We'd absolutely like to support you with your conference. But I do have a question, actually. It goes to Amy, if you would. So Chief talked about this exercise in New York, and having grown up in New York, I could tell you it is not an ungoverned space. It, as far as large cities go, it's probably one of the safest large cities. But the megacity you described is quite the opposite. So what would you add to the Chief's course in order to get that, so that the students could get at that formal and informal? What kinds of things would you want our young officers thinking about as they had to deal with the complexities of the urban environment you described?
Thank you for the question. I think to understand ungoverned spaces and informality, you really, I mean, I'm at West Point, so what I like to teach in the classroom is the understanding of networks and systems thinking. So you have to be able to understand all the different components, but also how they interrelate and function together. And so I think often we look at this problem as in a linear way, and we can't do that anymore. We have to look at it in a nonlinear, space.
Sir. Got one here, sir. Okay.
Yes, Greg, I guess I would direct this at you because it cuts across a good share of them. I'm Steve Funk from U.S. Army Africa, and of course a lot of these urban areas, not just the megacities, are going to occur in our area of interest. Our conclusion so far is that human terrain is the key terrain, which is very, very important to us, and that this battle is best won in phase zero and phase one, so that we don't get to phase three. Phase three, probably the direction the chief is going is, he will learn a lot of information in that regard. I would propose that the approach right now that the chief has alluded to is necessary but not sufficient, in that a U.S. city has been brought out, may not be the best model of most of the cities that we would be operating in, that this informal and formal structure is absolutely critical for our soldiers to understand how to find out about it, how to influence, how to not alienate it, how not to create more adversaries than in fact we're trying to operate in. So I guess one thing that I would kind of say is, how do we establish a national intel priority for these urban areas in each GCC's AOR? Would be kind of important. I don't know if we can get INGIC to do that somehow, because we don't have any modern information about these urban areas and what parts are governed by whom and how. And the second part, I'd fully concur with Mr. Felix's idea that this may be such a big part of our future that it deserves an MCOE. So I'd like to get your comments.
Well, so let me briefly address the intel prioritization piece. I mean, you know, there's a process for how we do that and task assign. But the challenge that we've started to understand better is, in fact, we really don't even know what to analyze yet, what to gather data on, to understand exactly, you know, what makes a megacity tick. And, I mean, my dad told me a long time ago, you can give a hog a wash, but he's never going to tell you the time. Just sit there and look at it. So it's how does the city flow? It's basically a living organism, and stuff goes in and stuff goes out, and it's how do you assess and how do you start to categorize those elements of a city so that you can begin to understand what makes it work. So then when you have to partner with formal and informal authority structures and work with the different dynamic population groups and understand how food, energy, water get into and how waste gets out of, and then how military operations influence and impact those in second and third order effects. So we're actually commissioning a study that's going to model and get after what it is that we then have to start to gather data on. But you're right, there's a larger DOD IC issue of which ones do we start to target first and how do we start to work our way through it. And then with that, I'll turn it over to the panel if they've got anything they'd like to add. Okay, I think we have time for one more over here, sir.
Yeah, I think there's a common theme in the questions, and maybe I'll ask mine in a a little more pointed way that might be easier to answer, actually, and that is that it's pretty clear that we don't have a lot of cities, big cities in the United States, that mimic the characteristic of an ungoverned situation.
Right.
On the other hand, what you're emphasizing in your response to that was the complexity of the network. And we do have cities in the United States that have pretty complicated networks. And the ability to train against those networks, even though they may not be the same as what you might see in the particular city that you looked at, which, by the way, may not be the same as a city in another country in the world, might be the real training exercise. And my question is, are we looking seriously at opportunities within the country, within the United States, because the armed forces in general are not deploying so much? You know, we don't have so many overseas opportunities anymore to try and capture some of this that you say is important, which is maybe we don't have exactly what's in some of these other megacities, but we have the thing that makes it hard, which is we don't understand it. And that becomes an opportunity to potentially do data collection, figure out what the real questions are, and then go to those other places and do exercises like that. So the question is, are we looking at that as an opportunity since we're here? Are we looking at opportunities within the United States as training exercises beyond New York City, obviously, that have some of these characteristics of megacities that are not in the United States? Maybe they're not exactly the same, but do they have some of the characteristics that would allow us to prepare for going to those other cities?
So I'll just take one part of that. I think we know that there are, you know, our special operators do a lot of this, and we just don't hear about it. Sometimes we do, and that's not good. And this is about taking it from those small elements and scaling it up in a different way. Some will get very uncomfortable with that, and I think that's the conversation that has to go on with our civic leaders, that it's not only about training to be expeditionary, but it can also, through the partnership, train to secure our cities around the country. So it's good for the homeland security piece of it. It's good for the expeditionary part of that as well. And that partnership is central to that discussion. And then there will be the conspiracy theorists that will be out there as well that will cause challenges. So we got to get out in front of that. But it's the start of the conversation. It's not necessarily a new idea, but it's new in terms of maybe the scale that we're talking about with respect to the types of operations and training that we may be considering.
I'd just like to add to that. I think I'm sure there's lots to be learned in this country. The difficulty is that a lot of the networks aren't necessarily known in these ungoverned spaces, and that's where it's difficult. So you have to try and figure out who are the major influencers. So it could be the woman who's managing the tap. It could be in Pekin, Senegal, it's the hip-hop artists. So that's the complexity, I think, when we're looking at cities that aren't in this country. So yes, there's lots to be learned, but we also have to be cognizant that there's a whole other element to it as well.
I'd like...
Can I get one re-attack?
Since you're hosting it, so you get one re-attack.
Yeah, two things. First, don't misinterpret the question I asked. What you're doing at Fort Benning and bringing those kids, these young captains to New York, is exactly right. You got to use what you got. That's exactly right. And Amy's point about how you have to learn about the informal networks is absolutely right, too. One of the things that Fort Benning is the proponent for in the Army, and we at TRADOC G2 actually have an element which helps them, it's called network engagement. It used to be called attack the network. So back in the days when we were trying to roll up the IEDs in places like Iraq and Afghanistan, we established this attack the network capability, which looked at exactly what you were talking about, getting at the networks. Sometimes you say it takes a network to defeat a network. What attack the network taught us was, how do you find those critical nodes within those networks, which will give you an exponential capability to neutralize or reduce the effectiveness of those networks. So, Chief, I didn't want you to walk out of here thinking what you're doing with your course. That course is state-of-the-art and is absolutely fantastic. How we add that extra realism, and I think, Kevin, you're onto something about training off post. Absolutely, using existing infrastructure and developing relationships with the guard and the lead. And I think this has been extremely helpful. So I didn't want the tenor of the questions to besmirch the fact that what the Maneuver Center of Excellence is doing, both in attack the network and in training soldiers how to deal with urban operations, you guys are exactly heading in the direction the nation needs you to.
I'd like to add a comment, then we'll pass you the mic, sir. So I'm going to separate the answer, I guess, because there's social network analysis and then training facilities. All right, so the gaps identified on the training facilities were identified in 2014 by the Strategic Studies Group. That's what we're trying to address. So since we're talking about Fort Benning, take a look back at the first Ranger course in 1950s. It looks nothing what it looks like now. Right, so there's definitely room for improvement. This was the first pilot course. The other piece is that we are looking at developing Atlanta. Obviously, for us, it makes sense. We're there in an hour and a half. We can take those 1,000 captains throughout the year. Not only that, but the commanding general for the Army National Guard for Fort Benning is a former Atlanta PD and is currently a police chief for one of the suburbs in Atlanta, so he's going to help us with that effort.
So I'd like to thank our panel members for taking their time to come out and work with us here today. Thank you very much.
Hey, team, if you can just hold fast. Let me, on behalf of the group, let me thank Greg Rose for assembling this great panel. Greg, thanks for your leadership, and thanks for introducing your ideas of cities as an element of analysis. And then to Pat, thanks for your emphasis on the importance of enabling cyberspace capabilities for all of us, not just keeping it in two stovepipes. And Dr. Amy, your discussion of the expansion of urbanization and the informal networks therein. I've got 1,000 questions about that, but I'm sure we'll have the opportunity to ask all these questions and more through adult beverages later this evening. And then, Kevin, your emphasis on re-energizing our efforts with regard to megacities, and also thanks for your multiple mentions of Army warfighting challenges. And then, Dennis, your discussion of the actions that we're taking to operationalize the concepts that we've been discussing and thinking about to bring it to fruition as capability. So, again, as I coin these great team members into the elite club of mad scientists, please join me in another round of applause.